Hebrews 4. I was reading on it last night, and a couple of things really spoke to me. I'll just read from the start. It says, God's promise of entering his rest still stands. So we ought to tremble with fear that some of you might fail to experience it. For this good news that God has prepared the rest has been announced to us just as it was to them. But it did them no good because they didn't share the faith of those who listened to God. For only we who believe can enter his rest. As for the others, God said, in my anger I took an oath, they will never enter my place of rest. Even though this rest has been ready since the beginning of time, we know it is ready because of the place in scriptures where it mentions it in the seventh day. I'm just going to go on to verse 6. It said, so God's rest is there for people to enter, but those who heard this good news failed to enter because they disobeyed God. So God set another time for entering his rest, and that time is today.
Amen.
God announced this through David much later in words where he said, today, when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. And when I was reading this, I was thinking, you know, how often do we not disappoint God, but you know, that we sin and, you know, we fall short of his, you know, glory and his peace. But he always, always gives us another chance.
So good.
The word today is not actually, you know, a certain date. Everyone will have it today, and everyone has a choice. When they can accept Jesus, or when they can come into his place of rest. And I just wanted to encourage you this morning that when we read these verses, it's a Sabbath rest. It is a special rest. It is a special rest that God prepared. And it will be different for everybody, maybe. But what he does say for everybody is that in Hebrews 11, it said, let us do our best to enter this rest. When I looked at other versions, when it said do our best, it said we should do our best, we should strive, we should do everything in our power to make this a choice that we go into every day, whenever it's needed. It should be a priority. And I just felt really stirred to share that it's our very best that we actually have to put in to finding that rest with God. Whether that's standing and worshiping, whether that's sitting and reading the Word of God, it's essential that we read and we get into the Word of God.
Amen.
So I'm just going to invite you to stand and we're just going to worship. Jesus, we just thank you, Father, for your word, Father. Jesus. Lord, we thank you that we can find rest, Lord, when this world seems so crazy and our minds can be so busy. But you have that rest ready and waiting since we were even born, since the beginning of time. Jesus, just help us enter that rest in your presence now this morning. Jesus.
There's nothing worth more than ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're higher than in your prayer.
Walking
into the room. Sickness starts to vanish in every situation. Ceases to exist when you walk into the room. Death begins to rise as there is resurrection left.
When you feel the room,
Into your presence, Father, is such a blessing, Father. It renews, it restores, it changes. Lord, we just pray, Lord, that we would all be open, Lord, to your word and your presence here this morning, Lord, so it can be transformational. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
But you're so welcome this morning, whether you're here in person with us or you're joining us online. And if it's your first time, you are especially welcome to the community church here in Inwood, because we are what? Family.
Amen.
So, this morning I just wanted to share encouragement. So Christina and I had the pleasure of being at a Pulse camp this week. And if you don't know what Pulse is, well, I say camp, it was more of a retreat. But if you don't know what Pulse is, it's part of Christian Church of Ireland's youth ministry. And we were able to go along to that. And guys, oh my gosh, like, we're talking about rest and restoration and restoring ourselves. And that was definitely a weekend of encouragement for several reasons, but also to see how big God's kingdom is. Mm-hmm. And you know, Ireland is tinier than other places, but we're not tiny, we're massive in terms of our heart for God. And just to see revival come and to see actually how much potential we have, even here in Oma, is just so, so exciting. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to share a part of a scripture that I actually had as my devotional after the first session. And we were talking about rest and recuperation, and it just brought me back to kind of what we were speaking on last week about reflecting and how we do that. And so it's from Hebrews chapter 4, verses 8. I'm just going to read a little bit down. It says, "For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken later, but another day. There remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For anyone who encounters God's rest also rests from their works, just as God did from his. Let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest, so that no one will perish by following their example of disobedience." And what really stands out to me is verse 10, "For anyone who enters God's rest also rests from their works." And that's because we understand and we appreciate what rest looks like, and we understand and desire the need to rest because we know why God rested. And so I just want to encourage you this morning, as Tim comes up to speak, that, you know, as we reflect, as we meditate on God's word, like he was saying last week, are you running to rest because you know you need it? Or are you running to rest because it's the thing to do? And that's a big, big challenge for us to think and contemplate as we go into our week. And as we worship as a form of resting, are you worshiping saying, Holy Spirit, come? Or Holy Spirit, come? Because there's a difference, a massive difference. Mm-hmm. So just be open to hear what Tim has to say about rest and about reflecting and everything else that comes with that this week. So let's pray before Tim comes. Yeah, Father, we just thank you that we can rest in you, that you gave us a desire within us to rest because you rested. And so, God, we just pray that as Tim comes to speak, that your words will just meditate on our hearts and in our ears and in our minds and everywhere, God, that we can go out better people, bigger people, changed people this morning for your word and have that impact our life daily. In your name we pray.
Amen. Good stuff. Hey, Jenny, thank you. Ellie, thank you so much. As a communicator and as a teacher, it's always nice when you hear other people championing the message that you've been shouting for a while. And you know that I'm big on rest, and I talk about rest a lot, and we operate from a place of rest, and that we don't live to rest, we live from rest. And it's just so refreshing to hear other people championing that lifestyle. And I'm so grateful for both of you this morning and just bringing that whole thing to life. So hey, if you are joining us for the first time this morning in this series that we are calling, or I have called, titled the series, 5 R's to reframe your day. Essentially, by owning our days, we own our lives. And so when we reframe our days, we reframe our lives. And so these are principles that practically I have applied to my own life that have brought about healing, restoration, and transformation. And so in week one, we looked at the importance of recognizing how we feel, what's going on in our world, in our lives, and what we needed to submit and surrender to God, recognizing and also understanding that when we carry our burdens to him, that he carries them away.
Amen.
And that we no longer have to carry those burdens, and please, like we would with our home rubbish, we don't take them back, and that we give them to him, and that we release them to him and allow him to carry our burdens as he has promised. And then we looked at the importance of remembering. Our second R was the word remember, remembering what Christ has done. And I encouraged you to potentially think about having a daily communion with the Lord, not necessarily breaking bread with the Lord in the traditional sense as we do on Sunday mornings, but taking a moment of every day. Sorry, I'm looking over there because that's where we do it in the mornings. I see something. And that's where we break bread. Normally when we do our 9:30 communion service, we go over into that area. And so kind of this whole idea of remembering is taking that time in our day to remember, hey, I'm saved. And I'm saved because of the finished work of the cross. And because of the blood that was shed for me and the body that was broken for me, I'm a child of God. And so I take that opportunity every day before I start my day to just go, okay, I'm a child of God, I'm saved. And what that then allows me to do is to reframe my day. Last week, I looked at the importance of reflecting on the Word of God. Not just reading the Bible, but actually meditating on the Bible. And rather than thinking what the Bible might mean to us, actually asking the Holy Spirit to reveal something of the character of God and the nature of God, the goodness of God, the power of God, and the sovereignty of God to us in such a way that we could actually carry that with us into our day, and it wouldn't just be a blessing to us, but it would be a blessing to those in our sphere of influence as well. And so this morning is the penultimate message in the series, and I'm going to look at the importance of reading, okay? And what reading is a generic term that I use for the receiving of information that will help me to grow. So when I use the word read, what I'm referring to is listening to podcasts, looking at YouTube videos, reading books, looking at other sermons, allowing other people to be an influence in our world and in our lives, but for the purpose of my 5 R's and for me to be able to remember it, because these are the 5 R's that I record every day. We look at the importance of reading. And so if we want to grow, we need to have fresh input. And fresh input brings fresh perspective. And then when that fresh perspective is applied to our lives, we actually position ourselves at new levels and we grow. You will see to my right that there is a ladder. And if I wasn't feeling so unwell today, I would be using the ladder, and I brought it down, and I'm just sitting here and I'm thinking, do you know what, the ladder's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. But the illustration was going to be about how each time we gain perspective, we move up when we apply it to our lives, and that God is always bringing us to new levels. Last week, when I was talking about changing the record, and we had the very visual illustration of the crossfader, somebody in the room, and I don't want the person who was in the room to go, oh, that was me, but somebody in the room made the comment or made the statement that what if it's stuck, okay? I had a chat with a gentleman by the name of Shawnee Miler last week. Some of you will know Shawnee Miler. He's the father of Connor Miler, who was a Tyrone GAA player. Shawnee was also a Tyrone GAA player. Both of them have had the honour of lifting the San Maguire Cup. But Shawnee Miler runs a coaching, life coaching business called Miler Performance. And Shawnee and I are loosely associated with one another. He is part of the Human Harriers, and when I was last training to go to the World Championships, he was a life coach with me, and he was speaking into my world, and he was speaking into my life. And I just happened by chance to have a conversation with him during the week. And I actually said, Shawnee, what do you think is the number one thing, in your opinion, as a coach, helping people to reposition themselves from where they are to where they want to be, going from here to there, essentially, what do you think is the one primary thing that keeps people stuck? And he said, it's a lack of fresh perspective. He says, they don't have the vision to see beyond their current circumstance. And because they don't have the vision to see beyond their current circumstance, they don't believe that they can move forward, and therefore they stay stuck. And this was my experience, and this is why this whole series has come to life, is because I didn't have the vision, I didn't have the perspective to believe that I could change, and I got into the pits of hell, was massively suicidal, as you all know. And then I recognized and realized that something needed to change, and I opened myself up to some fresh perspective. And when I opened myself up to some fresh perspective by beginning to change my habits, my life began to change. Because I had fresh input, which brought fresh perspective, which brought a new way of living that I was obedient to. And so what I want to do this morning, if that's okay, is encourage you in this process and encourage you on this journey to recognize, particularly if you're feeling stuck, or maybe you have felt stuck, or maybe you will feel stuck in the future, that when you get fresh input, you get fresh perspective, and when you apply the fresh perspective, you can find a new way of living. So at the beginning of 2020, I set myself the target or the goal of becoming a fitter, faster, stronger, healthier, happier version of me. And Lord knows we all needed it, didn't we? That was hard work. I was very broken, and I wanted to be a fitter, faster, stronger, healthier, happier version of myself, because the Tim Shields of 2019 could not continue into 2020. It just couldn't continue. Something had to change. So I wanted to be fitter. In other words, I wanted to build new levels of endurance so that I could have the greater ability to persevere. We were having coffee earlier on downstairs, and Brendan laughed and joked, and he said, I've never met anybody who's been attacked so much by the devil in all my life in the way that you have. He said, paraphrasing then, the ability to persevere those sustained attacks comes from fitness. So being spiritually fit is really important to me. So when I talk about being a fitter, faster, stronger, healthier, happier version of me, this is not applying to my physical life, this is applying to my life. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So I wanted to be fitter, I wanted to be faster, I wanted to be faster in saying yes to the things that I needed to say yes to, and no to the things that I needed to say no to. Because we all know, I was running around everywhere saying yes to everything, and no to some of the things that I should have been saying yes to, and so on and so forth. And my life was just an absolute horrendous mess. I wanted to be stronger, but I've come to realize that my ability to carry the weight that I was carrying led me to burnout. And so what I needed to do was reframe it in such a way that I recognized my strength comes from God. My strength comes from God. Because I was trying to do everything in my own strength and of my own strength. I also wanted to be healthier. My inner voice was really loud, but it was also really negative. And the loudest voice in my world and in my life at that time was the negative inner voice that led me to want to not be alive. So I needed to change the record. I needed to be healthier. But I also needed to be happier. And the funny thing about it is that by being fitter and faster and stronger and healthier, I could actually become happier. Because the joy was a fruit of the rest.
Yeah.
And so by focusing on what can I do to be fitter, what can I do to be faster, what can I do to be stronger, what can I do to be healthier, I actually found joy. And I could be happier. And so the Tim Shields of 2019 had to die in the best possible sense. The Tim Shields of 2019 had to die, not by jumping off a bridge, oh my God, but he had to die. Okay, right, okay. And the Tim Shields that was going to be birthed and created coming into 2020 had to bring new habits into his world and into his life. You see, here's the thing. And here's what I want you to remember this morning. You can't create a new life with old habits. The Bible puts it like this. You can't pour new wine into new wineskins.
Into old wineskins.
Thank you. I shouldn't have read my notes. You can't pour new wine into old wineskins. Jesus is being questioned. And around fasting, and there's this whole big conversation, but in the middle of this conversation, Jesus says this, no one sews, it's Matthew chapter 9, and he says, no one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth onto an old garment, for the patch will pull away from the garment, making the tear worse. Neither do people pour new wine into old wineskins. If they do, the skins will burst, the wine will run out, and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour the new wine into new wineskins, and both are preserved. Whenever wine is fermenting, this is beautiful imagery of this process that Jesus was describing. When wine is being fermented, it actually expands, it grows. There's a process. And when you try to put something new into an old structure, cracks begin to appear. We have first-hand experience of this upstairs at the moment, where we have been building a new structure inside an old structure, and the cracks have begun to appear. And God bless Alan Miller and his vision and his heart and his wisdom and his desire for us to have a space where we can minister to our children week in, week out. But when we began, I'm using the collective we because I really have nothing to do with this, okay? But you know what I mean when I say this. When we began to, because we're all part of this, yeah? We're all part of this family. Alan is spearheading it and he's doing the work, you know what I'm trying to say, right? So when we began to do that, some cracks began to appear. Because when you try to put a new system in to an old system, cracks begin to appear. And so this was what I recognized at the beginning of 2020, was that if I was going to change, if I was going to reframe my life, that I was going to have to take ownership of my days, and the habits that led me to where I was in 2019, were not going to serve me in 2020. And so my question to you today, my challenge to you today is that what habits have you got in your world and in your life that are serving you no purpose? What habits are you currently living out on a daily basis that are not helping you to thrive? What habits are you journeying through on a daily basis that are limiting your ability to grow? And also, who are you allowing to influence you? Because the people in your world are either going to pull you back, they're either going to keep you contained, or they're going to release you to thrive. And I'm confident when I say this, is that we've got people in our lives in each of those areas. And some of those people might be dead, but we're still allowing them to be in our lives by remembering the stuff that they've said. Who's influencing you? Who's inspiring you and who's uninspiring you? Who's releasing you? Who's empowering you? Who's equipping you? Who's pulling you back? Because the reality of it is that if we've got people in our boat, if we've got people in our world, if we've got people in our sphere, in our circle of trust that are pulling us back, that are encouraging unhealthy habits, and we actually need to do something about it. I love how in John chapter 21, we see, so Jesus has lived the perfect life. Jesus has died the perfect sacrifice. Jesus has raised from the dead, his resurrection, and he walks the earth again. And when he walks the earth again, he appears to the disciples a couple of times. But there's this moment in John 21 where we see that the disciples go back to the place that Jesus had called them out of. And they're all influencing each other. I would imagine in this moment that there's a pity party going on. Think about it. Think about the moment. Think about the situation that they find themselves in. They've given up everything to follow Jesus. They've literally, like, they walked away from their families, they walked away from their employment, they walked away from their security. They laid down their lives to follow Jesus. And then Jesus dies on the cross. What do we do? What's going on? Everything that we had invested into, everything that we had sacrificed, everything that we believed that was going to happen, it's gone. And so we find them and they're in the boat. It says, afterwards, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. And they say, I am going out to fish. If there was ever a pity party, I'm confident that was a pity party. I can just hear the conversation. Why did we do that? Why did we do? Why, we're fools. We're idiots. We're idiots. He pulled the wool over our eyes. What did we do? And because they're all in the boat together and they're all listening to the same thing, they're all speaking the same thing. And they're all influencing each other in such a way that, gosh. And then, I love this because fresh input comes. And as the fresh input comes, the fresh perspective comes, and it says this. So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. And early in the morning, Jesus himself stood on the shore, but the disciples didn't realize that it was Jesus. And he called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered, he said, throw out your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. And when they did, they were unable to haul the net in, because of the large number of fish. And then the disciples whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. Fresh input brought fresh perspective, which brought something different into their world. Goes on and it says this, as soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him and jumped into the water. And the other disciples followed the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards away. When they landed, they saw fire, burning coals, there with fish on it and some bread. And Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish you have caught. So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153 in fact. But even with so many, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. And none of the disciples dared ask, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came, took bread, gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. And this was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. They were pointed back to Jesus. Fresh input brought fresh perspective, which reframed their day. I was speaking to another friend of mine during the week about this message that I was hoping to in some way communicate to you as best I could this morning, and we were talking around this whole idea of fresh input bringing fresh perspective, which brings fresh transformation. A couple of years ago, the Galway hurling team were on the hunt for a new manager, and when they were on the hunt for a new manager, they made the decision that they weren't going to have anybody from the hurling community on their interview panel. Because they understood this whole idea of, if we keep bringing the same people in, we keep listening to the same people, we're just going to get the same as we always have before. We need change. And so if we're going to have change, we need to have fresh input. Because we need fresh perspective so that we can be transformed. So they sat about creating an interview panel that had nobody from the hurling community on it whatsoever. So some of the people they brought in are names that you may or may not be familiar with. One of the persons that they brought in was a gentleman by the name of Bernard Dunn. Bernard Dunn is a former lightweight boxer. He's a former world champion boxer from Dublin. He now is the performance coach for the International Olympic Committee's boxing team in Ireland. So they wanted him to come in so that he could bring what he knew to the table in this conversation. Those of you who are rugby fans in Ireland will be familiar with the name Eddie O'Sullivan. Eddie O'Sullivan brought the glory years of rugby back to the island of Ireland. They sought Eddie O'Sullivan, and they asked Eddie O'Sullivan would he come, and would he sit on the interview panel, because they wanted to bring his fresh perspective so that they could get fresh input so that it would change. And lo and behold, they thought about bringing in this whole new team, and when they brought in this whole new team, how Galway Hurling operated was completely transformed, and they became a great success. Here's the thing, if you're feeling stuck, you need to look at who's around you. And you need to ask yourself the question, are the people that I'm surrounded by inspiring me to not lofty new heights? For us as the church, the question is this, are the people that I'm surrounded by pointing me to Jesus? Are they giving me fresh perspective on the revelation of who Christ is? Because if they're not, you need a new goal. Let me say it again, if they're not, you need a new boat. And I make no apologies for saying that. Because more often than not, the reason that we're stuck is because of the choices that we're making and the people that we are surrounded by. And more often than not, the people that we are surrounded by are influencing the choices that we're making. And so you've got to ask yourself the question, who am I allowing to influence me? Christine, would you put that picture up behind me, please, for a second? The gentleman in the middle, his name is Chris Nicketts, okay? Chris Nicketts is the first ever Down syndrome man or woman to ever complete an Ironman. Now, if you don't know what an Ironman is, it's a wild pile of stuff, okay? So an Ironman, it's a triathlon beyond triathlons. So they swim 2.8 miles, okay? Then they cycle 110 miles. Wow. And then just to finish it off, they run a marathon. What? That's an Ironman, okay? And the Ironman in itself is named an Ironman for a reason. Because it is a feat of strength, okay? When Chris was born, and they love Jesus, by the way, this family. When Chris was born, his parents had a decision to make. And the decision was this. Are we going to surround ourselves with people who are going to tell us that our son is never going to be able to do anything? Are we going to choose to surround ourselves with people? Are we going to allow our sphere of influence to inhibit our son's quality of life by the information that we're going to receive from them? And they made a decision to say no to every specialist, to every doctor, to every negative voice, because they believed that he was fearfully and wonderfully made. And just because their current sphere of influence at that time couldn't see potential, they refused to sit in that boat. They refused to sit at that table, and they sought out people, and they sought out opportunities, and they sought out spaces where life would be spoken in so that Chris could thrive. Chris has now just got a sponsorship from Adidas. Global sponsorship from Adidas.
Wow.
Some people would have had him aborted in the womb.
Yeah.
A global sponsorship from Adidas to champion sport across the globe.
Wow. Praise God.
Who's in your boat? Who's in your boat? Who's in your boat? And how are they impacting your world? How are they impacting your life? Some of us are in the boat on our own. And we're rowing against the tide. And we have no accountability, and the only person's voice that we're listening to is our own. Can I tell you this? If your thinking is stinking, the last person you need to be around is yourself. The last person you need to be around is yourself. I love that we've got this incredible community here. We're a family. We're here for you. I love that we've got people who champion community really well. I love that we've got people who just value people and the coming together for communion services and prayer times and connect groups and all of those things. Because you know what? These are the places and spaces that we need to inhabit. Because these are the places and spaces where you will hear life. These are the places and spaces where you will see life. These are the places and spaces where you will be encouraged to seek out life.
Amen.
Who's influencing you? In your sphere of influence, I'm not talking about the sphere of influence that you have, I'm talking about the sphere of influence that you're receiving. In your sphere of influence, you have an opportunity to receive revelation. And the beautiful thing is that revelation will always lead to revelation. Let me just show you this real quick. Matthew chapter 16 verses 13 through to 20. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do you say the Son of Man is?" And they replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" And Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. So Peter has revelation. What does he do? He communicates that revelation. And what does that do? It leads to revelation. God revealed the Christ to Peter, and Peter revealed him to the world. And this is the potential that exists in relationship for us. This is the potential that exists for us when we come together as a family, but also when we open ourselves up to receive from other authors and commentators and communicators around the globe. Can I say this, and please, I say this with the greatest of love, okay? If I'm the only spiritual voice that you're listening to, you're in trouble. If I am the only spiritual voice that you're listening to, you're in trouble. Revelation leads to revelation. And so when you open a book from somebody who has taken the time to sit at the feet of Jesus, to listen to what Jesus has said, and they write that book, and then you read that book, you get to receive their revelation. When you listen to another communicator, teacher, whether it be on YouTube, a podcast, whatever it is, with that revelation that they're releasing, that's really healthy. When you listen to a worship song that somebody else has created, that's really healthy. When you go into a commentary with somebody who has taken the time to study a particular book or passage of scripture and made it their life work, that's really, really, really healthy. If your spiritual experience, and you've heard me say this before, but if your spiritual experience is limited to 1 hour here on a Sunday morning, that makes as much sense to me as going to an all-you-can-eat Chinese buffet and only having a grain of rice. That's as much sense as it makes. So every day, what I do is I sit and I commit to either reading something, and I use the term read as a generic term for ongoing personal development. I'll either read something, listen to something, look at something, find something, okay? Because I understand that I always need fresh input, because I'm always needing fresh perspective, because my old habits can't serve my future life. So if you want to grow to become the person that Jesus died for you to become, it's really important that you seek to grow in every area of your life. Pete Scazzero, I'm glad I said that right. Pete Scazzero is an author of a fantastic range of books all around this concept of being emotionally healthy. He's got like the emotionally healthy Christian, the emotionally healthy disciple, the emotionally healthy leader, the emotionally healthy discipleship, and it's just like, you could probably put anything, the emotionally healthy husband, probably the next one he's going to write, you know, the emotionally healthy wife, and so on and so forth. But here's the thing, he's broken it down, okay? And he says to be fully human is to recognize that we are physical, emotional, social, intellectual, and spiritual. And I wonder for a minute, when was the last time you actually thought to yourself, jeepers, I probably need to pay a bit of attention to my physical health and actually find some information about how I can grow in that area? Or my emotional health, how can I grow in that area? Or my social life, and I don't mean by that going to Sally's on a Saturday night. How am I interacting and engaging with the world is what I mean. What am I like relationally and interpersonally with the people around me? What's it like to be on the other side of me? What do people get when they meet me, and so on and so forth? He also says intellectually, we have a brain that needs stimulated, and spiritual. And for us as the church, we are great at, you know, encouraging people to grow spiritually. And we should be, because we know that spiritual health is the be all and the end of all. But what Scazzero teaches us and demonstrates and shows to us is that all of these things feed into the spirit. So I'm constantly seeking out opportunities to do this. And I've applied this principle to my life called the 1% rule. I can't even remember if I alluded to it when we had Chris on the screen. I didn't. Good. Okay. So I'm going to close with this. It's the 1% rule. And this is what I want you to try over the next couple of days, okay? When Chris's dad recognized that Chris was made for more, he said to his son, I only need you to be 1% better tomorrow than you were today. So I only need you to add 1% commitment, energy, desire, habit, application, pursuit into your day. So you don't have to do an Ironman today, son. But if we add 1% to your day every day, I promise you that you're going to do an Ironman. So I've applied this principle to my life, and so I said to myself, what does that look like for me? How can I grow spiritually? I'm going to commit to reading one verse of the Bible today. That's all. Just one verse. Tomorrow, I read one verse yesterday. Do you know what? I can commit to reading two verses today. The next day, three verses. The next day, four verses. The next day, five verses. Just adding and adding and adding and adding and adding. Before I knew it, I was reading a lot more than I had been. Yes? Okay. I did the same with books. I made a commitment and I set myself a target of reading a certain number of books in that year. Okay? But I realized that there was no way if I was to say I'm going to read 50 books this year. That's a massive number. But what I realized was this, is that if I read one page a day, I'd read 50 books. Because I kept adding and adding and adding and adding and adding and adding and adding. And before I knew it, I was reading a couple of chapters a day. But I built into it, and I grew into it, but I formed the habit. And as I formed the habit formed me. You hear that? As I formed the habit formed me. I also then made a commitment to exercising. And I realized that whilst I was hugely unfit and massively exhausted, that if I could just commit to doing one thing, just one thing. So I ran 100 meters. And then I ran 200 meters. And 300. And 400. 5, 6, 7. And I think one of the things that we're afraid of when it comes to the pursuit of our preferred future, one of the things that prevents us from moving forward is that we have this picture and it's so far from where we are that we can't see the jump. But here's the thing. All my kids know this. You can only eat an elephant one bite at a time. But if you keep biting, you'll eat the elephant. Not if you're a vegetarian. Probably fake meat or something that you can get for that. Like jelly or jelly. But I want to hear me, listen to this. What would it look like for you tomorrow to commit to 1%? One prayer. One sentence, one page of a book, one verse of the Bible, one text message to a friend, one phone call, one walk around the block, one push-up, one sit-up, one back squat, whatever, one Zumba dance, whatever it is. What would it look like? Because when you form the habit, your habit will form you. And I believe this with all of my heart. When we make this daily commitment to get fresh input, we get fresh perspective, and the person that we see in the future actually becomes a reality. So imagine if you were to commit right now, right? Now, I'm confident of this, and I say this with massive respect. That you all see a completely different, those who knew me December 2019, you see a completely different person today. Completely different, right? 1%. It's a world of difference. It was only 1% every day. Imagine for a minute what your life would look like if you were to apply that simple. Jenny, let's get you back up. as I.
When I was going over the songs for this week, I wanted to do a song that maybe would stay with you for the rest of the week, just to remind you that you're a child of God. Because I think if you can remember that throughout everything that hits you during the week, it'll encourage you and it'll make you stronger. And that's all you need to remember. Three words: child of God. I am a child of God.
Amen.
So, let's stand.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance.
Yeah. Lord, no matter what. Obstacles, hurdles, mountains, periods of joy we hit this week, Lord, we will no longer be slaves to fear, Father.
Amen.
We will remember that we are children of God.
Amen.
And no matter what, you are beside us, all around us, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Amen.